We've gotten a lot more exposure, which is what you want to do in a campaign. We've been building our grassroots space because I think that's how this race is going to go. I mean, in modern politics, we've kind of gone back to old school. So in the few months since we've spoken, we've really just been reaching out to volunteers, building our building a presence in throughout the district of people who are excited for change. I don't know. I mean, I'd have to look into it, what the federal level could do. There are constitutional limitations on what the federal government can do in terms of, having an impact at the state level. But that said, I mean, it may be something that the federal government could help with. It may not be necessarily legislative. It could be through the executive branch, through the Department of Education. And there are a lot of paths that we could take to alleviate some of the pressure on students for costs for textbooks, particularly. It's one of those things where you've got a problem that can be solved in multiple ways, and you have to figure out what's going to benefit the students while also making sure that it's not an unrealistic option that won't actually be able to be implemented. What's interesting is it's not necessarily legislation that's directly targeted at students, because I think that comes across as pandering. Something, you know, that, oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to fix this problem for you. If the federal government can't do that, then I don't think I should make promises that I'll try to do something that the federal government shouldn't be doing. But what the federal government can do is help make West Virginia more stable, so that the thing that's so awesome about West Virginia, and particularly the students that I've taught, West Virginians really deeply love West Virginia, genuinely, and they really want to be here if they can. You know, you hear a lot of places where people, you know, sort of the common thing, refrain, like, I just got to get out of here, I want to leave, I want to go somewhere else, I want to live somewhere else. But that's not true here. I mean, some kids do, some people do want to leave, but most people would like to stay if they can. And so I think the best thing that the federal government can do is address the challenges that the federal government can address to make West Virginia a more stable economic base for people to build their lives and grow their families and really be invested in the local communities. One of the things that we need to look at is benefiting, making sure that more students have access to education that won't bankrupt them. But one thing I want to say is, I think in some ways we have our priorities upside down. And what I mean by that is the average cost, and this isn't true necessarily at WVU, could be more or less, but the average amount of debt that students graduate with across the country is around $25,000. And that's certainly a hefty amount of money to graduate from college with, hefty amount of debt to graduate from college with, especially if you're going into teaching or doing something that doesn't pay a lot. But routinely you see people go buy a car for way more than that, way more than $25,000. And I think we're sort of misaligning our priorities. We focus a lot on debt that actually is debt that you take on because it will make your career more successful, it will make you more money over time. And I think that we need to value that debt differently than we do buying a new car. So while we need to make college more affordable, we need to make it more accessible to people who can't afford it, whose families haven't been able to afford it for generations, I also think we need to be valuing education and sort of balancing those interests of educators and students. When we sort of evaluate what worth certain things have to students, we tend to look at we look at certain things, and it's not just students, worth generally. So what's it worth to people to get a new car? Well, you pay a certain car payment, and it's a depreciating value, and it's just, a depreciating asset. You're going to pay a certain amount for a number of years. You'll drive your car around, and it'll get you where you need to go, and that's great. But we look at school debt as something that is like, so difficult to overcome, when in fact that investment is an investment in someone's future. So I think we need to control the cost of education. I think we need to make sure that the loans that people are getting have reasonable interest rates. I mean, that's a huge part of this, where we have private companies that are charging really high interest rates. And, you know, we have the federal government subsidizing some of those loans, which is very helpful and should continue. And we have schools that are not worth what they're charging. You know, we've got schools that are sort of fly-by-night schools, for-profit schools, that I think are taking advantage of students at very high cost and not getting them the benefit of the degree that will make them money over time, that they can pay back that debt. The point is, I want to look at WVU differently than, you know, for-profit institutions that are charging huge tuition rates for degrees that aren't worth as much as a WVU degree. So this is one of the main reasons I'm running, is because I'm concerned about the future of West Virginia, which means I'm concerned about students, I'm concerned about young people. I want to make sure that students and people who have grown up in West Virginia know that they can stay here, know that they don't have to go away to some other state to have a job or to have, you know, to get a good education or to get access to health care. Too many people are leaving West Virginia and don't feel free to stay in West Virginia because we've seen so many challenges and so many misappropriated priorities in the state. So my main goal is to diversify our economic portfolio by helping the medical marijuana industry in West Virginia thrive. And the way that can happen is the federal government gets out of the way. The state has a law that makes it legal to get certain types of medical marijuana. And there's a question of whether the federal government will allow that to continue. So the federal government needs to legalize medical marijuana and let the states implement their laws. We also need to ensure that people who live in West Virginia have access to medical care, and that it's not contingent on where they work or how much money they make or how old they are. We need to make sure that the schools are supported with the resources that they need so that people can know that they can stay here and raise their kids and be assured that their kids will have a good education. You know, we in Morgantown have great schools. My kids are, you know, go to public schools, and I think their teachers are wonderful, and they're doing so much with a very little amount of resources. And I want to make sure that that's true for kids in every part of the West Virginia First District and every part of West Virginia. There's no legislation that speaks to whether marijuana should be able to be recognized as a legal substance in the states that have decided to legalize it. So we have here a traditional conflict between the federal government and state governments, and the founders of the United States created this sense of a laboratory of states, right? So that each state sort of has its ability to control its own laws and make rules that are appropriate for that place. And then the federal government has a limited amount of power that's dictated by the Constitution. Well, here's the case where the laboratory of the states, 30 out of the 50 states, or 29 plus the District of Columbia, have decided locally that they want to make medical marijuana, and in some cases recreational marijuana, legal. But the federal government has been sort of holding this power over the states and saying, no, we don't want you to implement your laws, or at least now. I mean, we've changed attorney generals in the Obama administration. The attorney general just said, I'm staying out of it. But the federal legislative side of this has never reflected that the states have the power to make those laws and enforce them, meaning that the states can legalize medical marijuana and recreational marijuana. So the federal government needs to get out of the way by taking marijuana off of Schedule I. Right now, marijuana is characterized as a very bad drug, like heroin and cocaine, and it's nowhere near. I mean, it's not perfect. Nobody could argue that it is. But it's a lot safer as a pain alternative than opioids, and yet it's characterized as this incredibly deadly, dangerous drug that it is not. If the state wants to legalize recreational marijuana, I think the federal government should get out of the way of that too. And I think that's more of a, what I would say, another states' rights issue that the federal government should not be dictating. And I would like to champion federal legislation to do just that, to let the states decide for themselves how they want to proceed when it comes to marijuana. Well, I think I'm one of only four congressional candidates in the country who has taken a leadership position on federal legalization of medical marijuana. And I think it's important that, I think it's fascinating to me that politicians are still hesitating on this issue because it seems so clear to me that it could be really beneficial, particularly in West Virginia. So I really want to emphasize that I am willing to lead even on controversial issues, even though it's really not a controversial issue. Most people agree by far that we should have legalized medical marijuana and that the federal government should not be in the way. But that's something that I really want students to know, is that I'm willing to, all ideas are welcome. Innovation, creative ideas, you know, as long as those ideas can help us improve, can help people, I'm happy to listen. And I think we should be listening to all of our constituents and not just a select few that have a ton of money. I mean, I think we need to, one of the big things is diversifying our economic portfolio. And I think a big part of that is helping communities sort of build up whatever it is that they want to build up. So agriculture is a big thing we're seeing in a lot of communities where you see this notion of, in big cities, like people talk about a gig economy, where people are doing multiple different things to make money and sort of make the economic base in the city more diverse. And the irony of that is that gig economies were invented in West Virginia. The whole idea, and places where people have always needed to do multiple things to make money. The idea that you would go to work during the day and, you know, drive your truck or dig a ditch and then go home at night and grow your garden so that you can sell vegetables at the farmer's market and make a little extra cash is the way that people have been living in West Virginia for decades, centuries. Why is it that we focus so much on supporting these innovative ideas in cities when in fact they're old school ideas here? And the federal government can be helpful. We can talk about seed grants for people, you know, small amounts of investment from a, you know, when you're looking at it from the federal government, it would be a small investment in a community, but helping local farmers get a farm up and running, which is expensive at the beginning and doesn't turn much of a profit. Industrial hemp would be a good example of a very versatile crop that people could grow in even small spaces and turn into a moneymaker. And we need to be thinking more about, listening to communities and investing from the federal level in feasibility studies to see what works. You know, the federal government shouldn't be coming in and dictating how communities want to turn around. We should be listening, and we should be investing the resources to find out what exactly those communities want for themselves. Instead of making communities go through the process of applying for grants, recognize what we know what the problems are. We know what the challenges are. The federal government can simply say to a community, here's some money that you can use to distribute to people who really want to make that community work and people who want to help that place thrive again. And so I just think the federal government sort of decentralizing and letting communities decide how they want to use investment funds when we see them struggling, particularly in light of the opioid epidemic, because we've got two problems there. One, we've got people who are struggling with addiction because they're already addicted and we need to get them treatment. On the other hand, once they're treated, we need them to be able to go home and go to a place where they can engage in the community and help rebuild the community and be a part of something that's moving forward. What I think people in communities are perfectly capable of doing, of writing grants. It's not that they're ignorant or that they struggle with grant applications in terms of an intelligence question. It's more that it's an additional burden on the time and resources of a community. Instead of actually getting the resources into the community and using them toward progress, they're spending their time writing grant applications. I think we can look at a community and ask, you know, have a conversation. We should have representatives that go to the communities and listen to what it is that they want, and then take that message back to Washington and say, this is what we need, let's fund it, instead of making people jump through hoops. There are people who are very concerned about our political direction in West Virginia, but I don't know that it's necessarily Democrat versus Republican. I mean, you see people sort of getting entrenched in those labels when, in fact, I think West Virginians care more about values and who they agree with and who they think they can trust in D.C. to represent their values. So we live in a state that's actually really politically diverse. People voted for Democrats for a long time. They've been voting for Republicans for a while now, too. But it's a state that you see people sort of deciding on the basis of the individual, not so much party, and I like that. I think it's important that we continue to serve people, with whatever, serve them in the way that they need, not in the way that the party dictates. And I'm not, I am a Democrat because I agree with the values of the Democratic Party in large part, but I am not a party person. So I don't have any requirement to do anything by anybody. I'm not being supported other than individuals who want me to go to Congress and support West Virginians. So that's who I owe my leadership to. So I still serve in both of those roles, mostly because, two things. One, I love my job, and I wouldn't do anything but my job unless represent the West Virginia First District in Congress. But two, I need the money. I'm a working person. And so I'm not going to step away from my professor position. If I win the primary, my goal is to step back from the associate dean position, which is actually perfect timing because my contract rotation is up in June. So it actually works out well that I would rotate out of that position as I was planning on doing, and just keep my faculty position so that I can maintain the income that my family needs, keep working with students, which I love, but also have some more flexibility to, spend some time. Right now I'm like all weekend, all night, just working long, long hours on the campaign trail, which would continue, but focusing on teaching would allow me to also focus on the campaign. Well, as I said before, it's not like women are magical unicorns who are going to fix everything. I mean, that's not, I don't mean to suggest that. But I do think that we really need and want different people representing us. And if we're thinking about how do we change who we send to Washington, there aren't a lot of women there. And I think a lot of women who are particularly running in 2018, because we're seeing a huge surge in women running, our priorities we're not entrenched in politics, we're kind of changing career, thinking about a career change by going into elected office, and then so we don't have any particular allegiance to anyone other than our constituents, and I think that is refreshing. So that's one thing, that women just haven't been elected very much in the past, and it would signify a real change. I also think it allows for women in Congress to come together in a different way. So doesn't matter if you're a Republican or a Democrat, women can come together and talk about issues that affect their constituents in a way that they haven't been, because there just haven't been critical mass of women to do that. So I think it's, coalition building, problem solving, and a lack of, of ties to funders or lobbyists that try to control the process in D.C. We're just, a lot of us are representing change. Biggest thing is turning I feel like we spend way too much time talking about very wealthy people and corporations. And I think every single piece of legislation, every single action that the government takes should be run through the filter of, is this good for people first? That's our first question every time. Is this good for people? Is it good for West Virginians? How is it going to impact the people who get up and go to work every day, who have kids in school, who are struggling to make ends meet? That's where our priority needs to be, and I think our priorities are way out of line. They're up here when they need to be more at the community level. I think we need universal health care. I think every single person needs to know that they have health care regardless of where they work, of how old they are, of how much money they make. I mean, part of it is people work, you know, if you work 40, 50 hours a week at, you know, CVS or McDonald's or something like that, first of all, you're not making a ton of money. And secondly, you don't get health care. But if you're working 40, 50 hours a week, maybe not making much more money than you would at an hourly job, but you work for WVU, you get health care. This seems wrong to me that we would have this just, you know, selection of, well, you happen to work here, so you get health care, you happen to work here, you don't. And so we need to decouple employment from healthcare. We need to make sure that every single person, no matter who they are or how much they make, or if they're senior or child or a college age student, gets healthcare. And I don't know exactly the right path to that. I can't say right now that I'm willing to say that this is the only way. We're going to do it this way, and that's the one answer. But and the reason why I don't want to commit to anything is because I want to get there. I want to make sure that when I go to DC, we have a path that gets us to healthcare for every single person that is that actually gets them health. I mean, we spend so much time talking about insurance. We should be talking about health. Our incentives are totally out of whack. I have a physical therapist I go see because I'm a runner and my knee's been bothering me. And my eyes have been opened to how much good we could do if the insurance incentives weren't set up the way they are and we really just addressed people's health. You know, if he has told me, if I could go into elementary schools and tell kids how to stand and how to organize their spines and how to move their bodies, we wouldn't have nearly as much back pain in adults because we'd know how to keep our bodies healthy and avoid that pain that you get when you do really heavy manual labor, which a lot of West Virginians do. And he can't do that because the way that our medical system is set up, he's not, you know, that's not how we do things. We wait until there's a problem. Then I have to go to my primary care physician, who refers me to an orthopedist, who refers me for physical therapy. I should be able to just go straight to the physical therapist. It's a lot cheaper, it's a lot more direct solution to the problem. But we have our incentives all wrong, so we're talking way more about insurance than we are about health.
It is.
You come back, you spend time here, you show up, you listen, I have two kids and a husband here, I'll be here a lot, and the whole point of this is to listen to the constituents and put their desires into action. And you can't do that unless you're on the ground paying attention. Vote. They need to vote. Students, but you know, and that's one piece. And students need to send people to Congress who are listening to them. And so they need to vote. They also, you know, I don't think that's too much of a burden. But we also need to be focusing more on students as people who are running for office or who are representing districts that have student populations. It's not always, you know, well, you have you're a student, you have a problem, it's on you to fix it. As an elected official, I need to make sure that I'm hearing your concerns and coming on campus and making students a priority. And not just showing up for photo ops when there's like something cool that's happening, but actually coming in for forums and listening to teachers and professors and all of the aspects of the university.